Hello and welcome to Virtual Concert Hall's live music channel. My name is Chris Sauer and I'm your host for today's excellent show because I am going to be interviewing and listening to the amazing performance of the Bayberry String Quartet. All of them are here to discuss with us what it takes to be a modern, innovative string quartet, as well as the challenges that may come with performing and rehearsing and being part of this amazing music industry, and as well as a very special Carnegie Hall performance coming up for the String Quartet. All of this is to serve musicians and music lovers out there by providing performances and music that is live and will give valuable inspiration for audiences out there. And it is because it is our passion to be connecting musicians and audiences in real-time musical performances and live programs from around the globe. Hello and welcome to Virtual Concert Hall's live music channel. My name is Chris Au and I'll be your host for today's really exciting show. Before I introduce the members of the Bayberry String Quartet, I wanted to emphasize how amazing this season has been already. We've already had incredible choral orchestra auditions. We've already had Carnegie Hall auditions, as well as many performances that have happened in venue in live. And this is really special because it is our goal in a way to blend the two models where we can have auditions online, but performers are able to perform in live venues like Carnegie Hall and with live orchestras like the Winnico Orchestra, with the New York Chamber Players Orchestra, as well as many different ones we have in Cairo, the Cairo Opera Orchestra, as well as one in Czechia. So all of this is really to provide value for musicians, young musicians out there who want performance opportunities, who want to get out there and meet other musicians. And I think this is a wonderful way because everyone has an internet connection. Everybody has a camera and a microphone and a screen to put their playing out there. And it's very interesting that we can combine these two models. All the auditions you hear of musicians are live and the judges give live feedback for these musicians. And this season has been so amazing. We've had so many different shows and let's have a look at what's in store for the rest of the season as well. So we're already past the mid point of our season and there's so many things left to come, especially a very exciting Carnegie Hall performance in July. But we've gone so far, and this is our fourth year as an organization, organizing concerts, competitions, auditions, and performances. Last week, we had a fantastic performance of the Rachmaninoff First Piano Suite for two pianos at the Corbin School, and we were broadcasting live from there. And these are just a little snippets of what we're possible, what's possible out there in our season. And I want to tell you about an upcoming auditions that we have for the Carnegie Hall, as well as the choral orchestra auditions that are May 17th and 21st and June 14th to 17th. These auditions will inevitably be live, but also there'll be judges who will give live feedback. And some of this can be really interesting. And what's really fascinating about these live auditions is that the judges get to hear the piece and they give you feedback right away. And so it's very fresh. Just don't forget that the deadline for auditioning for these is going to be May 10th. And there'll be more opportunities to come up. So if you missed that, don't worry, but please check our websites for any material that you may need or audition. We are trying to be as open as possible with what we accept from age limit to repertoire to different genres. We're trying to accept as many people as well. We even had like different Indian traditional music being performed recently in one of our Carnegie Hall auditions. So we're really trying to embrace this world, because the amazing thing about the internet is that it's worldwide. And so everyone can sign up and everyone can be a part of our season. And if you want to perform with orchestras and at Carnegie Hall. So this is really, really fascinating. And leading up to these performances, because it's not just performances all the time, we have these interviews which you're about to witness, and these are from guest artists, musicians, judges, music promoters, and all different parts of not just our organization but organizations out there who are providing value to musicians. We're going to have an amazing conversation next Saturday with a music promoter and agent, and to see how this whole industry works on his perspective. And so we invite musicians and educators, publishers, and many different people to be part of our show, so we can pick their brains and really figure out what it is that makes their careers work, and what it is that, depending on where they are in the world, what they're doing, and how to innovate and how to be productive and fruitful members of this music society. Today, I have the wonderful privilege of interviewing all four members of the Bayberry String Quartet, who will be performing in the Laureates Gala on July 1st, 2024 at 7 p.m. So these amazing musicians will be performing some new music, and you can't miss it. It's gonna be so amazing. And they will be talking to us about what this concert will be like, as well as all the other things that they're doing in their lives and how they began. So let's introduce them. I'm gonna start from the violinist and violist and cellist. So the violinist, Nurit Pat, was a top prize winner in the international competitions, including the Irving Klein International Music Competition in California and the Tibor Varga International Violin Competition in Switzerland. As a soloist, she's been featured in many world events, such as the European Conference for the Inauguration of the Euro in Brussels, and under the auspices of the European Commission and United Nations. She's toured the former Yugoslavia during the ceasefire in 1996. She's given performances to amazing people, including the Pope Francis, and has toured and as a soloist in with many amazing orchestras, and has a master's degree in Juilliard's Historic Performance Program, and she's just an incredible musician. I can't wait to hear some of her performances today in this broadcast. Another violinist in the string quartet, Steffani Kitayama Bolkovsky, splits her time between teaching, performing, and dancing with a small ballet company in Michigan. How does she do that? We'll find out. She holds performance degrees from University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music and Northwestern, studying with Wonbin Yim and Blair Milton. She does so many different things with different orchestras and ensembles, and she currently resides with her husband, Gabe Bolkovsky, who I will introduce soon, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and teaches at institutes such as across the states and abroad. This is really amazing. Now, violist Gabe Bolkovsky has performed and taught across the United States and abroad. Primarily a violinist, he performs a diverse repertory of classical and contemporary works with different collaborative artists from many genres of music making. He's released 7 CDs, which shows his breadth as a musician, from contemporary music, jazz, tango, as well as, of course, the traditional classical music. He has spent 6 years as a guest artist at the University of Michigan Ann Arbor, teaching violin and chamber music, and is also the executive director of the Phoenix Ensemble. He has also recently founded an organization, Musicians Take a Stand, which encourages musicians to hold concerts for humanitarian causes and raises money through social media platforms, which is incredible. And last but definitely not least, cellist Laura Usiskin has performed throughout North America and Europe in such venues as Kennedy Center, Alice Tully Hall, and Viral Recital Hall, Bach Music, and many, many more. She is a graduate of the Juilliard School, as well as the Yale School of Music, and also a graduate of the Columbia University, studying the Bachelor of Arts in Neuroscience and Behavior. She currently resides in Atlanta. And just a little preview of what the Bayberry String Quartet itself has also done. They're emerging into the concert scene with upcoming performances at Carnegie Hall and the Chautauqua School of Music. Very exciting. And they have other concerts include at the Lincoln Center, and much, much more. They're only in the 6th season. They've enjoyed residencies at the Step Birmingham Chamber Music Workshop, Peaks to Plain Institute in Colorado, and PhoenixPhest in Michigan. They perform a wide range of different genres, which we're going to hear today. It's very exciting, including a piece called Frankenstein, which we will listen to. In 2024, the Bayberry String Quartet will release an album of early Mozart quartets, and please visit www.bayberrystringquartet.com for more information about their upcoming concerts and to see their videos and their photos and everything they have. Without further ado, let's get them on screen. Welcome to the show. It's such a pleasure to have you. So great. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for having us, Chris.
Yeah, nice to be here.
It's a pleasure. My first time interviewing a full string quartet. Usually we get different members, and it's so nice that all of you are here. So I don't even know who to turn to for this question, but I want to know how this whole started. Is this 6 years in the making? So how did it start? Let's see, let's do the math here. In 2018?
That's right. I'll take it. I'm Laura. I'm a cellist in the quartet. Hi. It started really with a festival that Gabe ran for a long time called PhoenixPhest that you mentioned. It's a chamber music festival that had a weekend program and also a week-long program, and all of us taught there. And so he knew all of us, and also there were faculty concerts and as part of the festivals that we would play and perform there. And the quartet itself started with the two of them wanting to form a quartet, and they're married, and so I'm sitting in the middle between the two. And then from there they asked me, and so then we were three, and then we very nervously asked Narit to join us. We showered her with cheese and wine and asked if she would please join us. It was a good day.
And yeah, it was a little bit like three proposals for me in a sense. So, yeah.
That's true. That's the way to do it, I guess now, Laura, is to shower them with cheese and wine. If you want someone to join your string quartet, that's the way to go about it.
It worked. And you did the math right. So that was in 2018, and that's when we started.
Yeah. How has it been? Is it tricky to organize rehearsals together? Is it do you have a yearly meeting point where you do a lot of intense rehearsing and come up with a plan? How does it all work, especially when you are also busy with your own commitments?
Yeah, you know, it's been taking a lot of creative problem solving, and it's led us to some really interesting and we feel deeper places than we expected. As we do live in separate places, we spend quite a bit of time with a system that we created, an online rehearsal system, where we, before the pandemic, over a period of a year or two, we created a system for being able to rehearse. And most of the people we've tried to show this to have been concerned that it's actually pulls you away from the music a little bit. But what we found was that it moved us much closer to each other because of the nature of the listening that's involved. It's much more careful listening. And then, of course, we still have to get together quite a bit in person.
Could you tell us a bit about that this online rehearsal space and the system you've created?
Yeah, I think what everybody was trying to do up front was try to find a way to play at the same time. And what we did was we sort of deconstructed the rehearsal process where we recorded more like we were the Beatles. So we found, initially we used BandLab, which is the founder is just an amazing person. And now we use Soundtrap. But we layered our parts, and we would create several recordings of these layers. And then we would get together and scrutinize. And really talk about very deep details, everything from pitch to intonation, but also qualities of sound and phrasing and everything you would talk about in a string quartet rehearsal. But we had the opportunity to keep going back and listening rather than relying on our memory of what happened, which is what happens in most rehearsals.
Yeah.
Everybody has a subjective idea.
Yeah.
You're able to keep going back. And so if there were disagreements, we could listen again to the same exact moment.
Wow.
So in a nutshell, that's what we
do. Is it so you have maybe, if you're all in different places, you have a program that combines, so you record your track as a violist, and then Laura records hers, Steffani and Nurit, and then you kind of put it together. Obviously, there must be some metronomical-ish beat to keep it all together in a way, but then you listen to many versions, perhaps, of that, and then you say, okay, so I really like this at minute 1:45, I really love this section, and that sounded great, but maybe we could change the way we shade this or phrase this. Is that how it works, kind of?
Yeah, I think you're catching on to it for sure. Yeah, it's this layering of the parts. And I still remember the first time we did it. The first time we were just testing it out was in 2018, and we didn't do it with our whole program. We were playing a concert, and we did it with about maybe half of the movements, where we would layer, and we'd listen back, and we'd scrutinize. And the parts that we had done it with were a lot better. I mean, it really worked, and it was very exciting to be able to make that kind of progress. So it's what we've been doing, and we have a lot of different permutations and a lot of different ways that we rehearse different parts. We've kind of developed and honed our system, of course, always tweaking it. But it also allows us to be looking at the score a lot more than we would if we were in person, because we're meeting online, and we have one score that is our score. We make all of the markings we have to make sure match with that score. It's a very deep process. We get into music on a really deep level and get to know all the parts really well. And it's proved to be great for us.
Amazing.
Yeah, we really loved it.
I would just want to bring the question to Narit. How have you found this system as the newest member of the string quartet?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I can tell you that I've played in a lot of festivals where they included into the festival program open rehearsals. And one of the things that we would often hear from the audience would be, oh, that was a little disappointing. I mean, there was so much talking going on. We didn't hear much playing. And actually, that speaks to what we experience is we're actually having conversations about the music. And we meet very rarely for those conversations. And we're the four of us are looking at the score, and we're using our imaginations, and we're kind of using muscles that we're forced to use more intensely, because we don't just rely on the physicality of playing our instruments. So then when we finally do come to the instruments and we finally do get together, which is actually quite often, we come with a lot of mutually found ideas of the music.
I love that. I always find, like, as a pianist, I always find myself improving a lot when I'm recording myself in a studio or otherwise. And I have to force myself, obviously, because it's a recording, to listen back. And you realize so many things. And I can only imagine how beneficial it is as a string quartet to constantly be able to listen to yourselves. And that's a part of your rehearsal process. You know, Steffani, can you speak to a little bit about that? Or how is that beneficial to you as a dancer? You probably see yourself in the mirror so much that it's a part of the same thing where you're able to really scrutinize what you're doing.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I think normal musicians, that we kind of have to force ourselves to record and listen back. But because it's part of what we do, we've sort of gotten used to it. And there's really like a vulnerability to it, right? Like, we're going to listen to my second violin line where I play, you know, like a whole set of eighth notes. And it's really cool. I feel like it's gotten us, we really know each other's playing well. And we've been able to just get closer, like as people, because we're able to put ourselves out there like that for each other.
Yeah, you're forced to really look more big picture in a normal rehearsal setting, as opposed to, I have a lot of notes here, can you guys take some time, or can you not rush me here? It's this idea, you're looking at more of a bird's eye view while still playing your part. That's fascinating. My next question is going to be about the next piece we're going to listen to. It's the Frankenstein by the Edgar Winter Group, which is played by the Bayberry String Quartet. Who wants to talk about it? I don't know whose idea it was. I don't know who came up with it or who started the collaboration. But I'd love to know as much as I can about it, and then we'll play the video.
Well, as with everything with this group, it's hard to know like whose ideas were whom. But there are a few things we can lock down.
Okay.
Narit's husband, Rami Vamos, did this arrangement. And one day, Narit said, "Hey, do you want to try it out?" So that was sort of already in the works, but when the pandemic hit, we were trying to figure out how to create how to create together. And so it kind of morphed, and I think it was right around Halloween, right? And so it morphed its way into what we decided would be a Halloween video that we recorded through this online process because we couldn't be together at all. So we recorded our parts separately, and then we did the video. Steffani and I particularly had to learn a lot about lighting and editing, and so I guess I could say I sort of directed the film, and Steffani did all the editing. It was quite a rich creative moment for the group because we were so locked into the situation we couldn't see each other. So.
And what's amazing is usually people who have to do that during COVID, it would be their first time recording like four parts and trying to piece it together and like, oh, does it sound good? But you're so used to it.
Right.
That's the least of your problems. It's the other stuff. It's the visual and
right.
how it all looks, right? Okay. Well, right. let's have a listen to it. I can't. I'm so excited.
I just want to add, we brought in a drummer named, a local drummer from Ann Arbor named Pete Siers, who just miraculously he added the drum part to this. So just to say, it was really, really amazing. Yeah.
All right, let's watch it. We'll be right back.
A tune.
Oh, this is so fantastic. I love it. I love it. So what is it like to rewatch this now? There's so many costume changes. I think, Steffani, you had the most. I think I was, right? Am I right to say, I think you've got the most.
It's so zany. It's just hilarious to watch.
I'm like in tears.
Yeah. It's a combination of entertaining and embarrassing, I think.
But the thing is, it wasn't just like you had four of you, you know, in different corners of the room. It was like a lot of motion. And as a video editor, Steffani, you did a really great job. It felt like one of those music videos from like the 90s where they didn't care. It was just whatever happened. And people were moving around and they were jamming and it didn't have to really make sense. Maybe there's a story I'm trying to get out of.
Well, if we were trying to, we were thinking sort of in the style of Edgar Winter, like that felt like a video that maybe he would make, you know, where Frankenstein turns into the wizard and, you know, it doesn't make any sense at all. Yeah.
And there's the Dorothy and there's Batman. You made a Batman reference and then it kind of just started to, what's Batman got to do with Frankenstein? But it worked.
Right. Yeah. So that was how we spent our spare time during the pandemic. Yeah.
No, I love it. I think that's fantastic. So is this one of the few things you've done innovatively, or have you done other projects, or are you going to do other things like this?
Well,
go ahead, Nuri.
Maybe this is a good opportunity to talk about our Mozart recording that we're releasing in June.
Oh, yes, of course. Yes, there's a new, the early quartets. Yes.
So we're planning to do, we've recorded all of them, and our plan is to turn those into videos as well. But we're going to do we're calling online listening guides. So we'll be doing, hopefully we won't be dressed up like women or anything, but we'll be.
Please.
Maybe we should rethink it. I don't.
I think so. I think it works. It's a thing now for the Bayberry String Quartet.
That's right. but we're hoping to do is create a way for people to listen to the music. But sometimes people with classical music, they, you know, it's almost like we're creating the art, but we're also sort of docents, and so it's helpful to give people little clues about what to listen for within the music. Hopefully without being too cerebral about it, but just to help them be able to notice certain conventions that maybe they wouldn't necessarily pay attention to. So that's going to be maybe our most interesting upcoming videos would be.
And when is that going to be released?
That's going to come out in June of this year. So it's coming up, and you'll be able to visit our website for more information to get your copy. a digital or a CD version of it in June. And you asked about sort of being an innovative quartet. And I think a lot of quartets, when they think of innovation, they think of playing new music, which is something that we do. And that's what we're going to be doing at Carnegie in July. Another thing that we want to talk about on the show. So we've enjoyed working with composers and playing newer music. We also really enjoy the classics and spend a lot of time playing Mozart and Beethoven, Dvorak, Prokofiev, looking back and trying to find that fresh perspective on some of the more standard works. So that is a big part of what we do. If people attend a Bayberry String Quartet concert, they're probably going to hear some Mozart or some Beethoven. And they're going to hear a lot of these standard works. And we bring a lot of different backgrounds to the table in our own musical upbringing. Some of us have studied early music, some Baroque. And so we approach things like Mozart from the early perspective. A lot of us have done a lot of new music. So we are able to approach those standard works kind of from all sides. And I'm really excited about the album coming out because we had a lot of fun working on the Mozart and playing it. It's sometimes in a way that is maybe unique and maybe new and fresh.
And just, I just want to make sure I ask this. How did you record it? Was it separately or were you actually finally together to do this?
That's an appropriate question. Yes. In this case, we actually did the standard in the room. Okay. We talked about it. We talked about doing it. And I said, no, let's do it. Let's do it the standard way. Yeah.
How was that process? So you obviously rehearsed it online with your system, and you get together and you know it's not just a performance you do a few times, and you know it's okay. It's good. It's good enough. Great. But this is a recording where you want it to be. You know, you need that extra little bit of perfection. So what did you do when you were together to try to attain that sort of level where you were all happy with?
Right. I mean, we do get together in person a lot. So it's not like we're just always online. So we do get together a lot. And we know, and our musicians know, that the more you play, the deeper you get, the more details you find. And we wanted to take our time with it. So we spend years preparing these Mozart quartets. There are six of them in his first set in the Milanese. That's what we recorded. And we recorded them over a year and a half. We had three different sessions to give ourselves time because we knew we wanted to have dug into every measure, every crevice, every note, every phrase. And we knew this, the more we dug, the more we'd get it. So, and we had a lot of, we performed them a lot as well before recording, because those, like you said, you kind of want that bump, sort of to get a performance ready and then to listen to the performance and then get it ready for the next performance and just keep bumping and bumping until we get to the point of, okay, we're this is what it is right now. And this is our version today and we feel good about it.
And these pieces are particularly heavily leaning in the direction of the first violin. And so there's that intangible thing that's harder to get when you're doing the kind of online work where we really wanted to be able to, have a kind of electrical line to Nurit's fingers to really, and her heart, to be able to kind of sing along with what she's doing and make sure that we got that little extra, like you're saying.
Right. And then to feel like all that cheese and wine was definitely worth it, to get in and to have a magical touch. I wish we had a clip of the Mozart, but why don't we listen to some Haydn, which I'm sure is going to be just as good too. This Haydn, the String Quartet in C major, Opus 20, number 2. It's a short clip of it. Nurit, do you have anything to say about this quartet or any by way of introducing it for us?
Oh, this, I think we're going to listen to a clip from one of the Opus 20 Haydns, and it's very, I mean, Haydn is like the father of string quartets, and Beethoven admired him, and this is so creative, the writing in this movement is so creative, so operatic, very rhetorical, and had a lot of fun working on this. Actually, this was one of the first quartets that we worked on seriously. So now that we're going to listen together, I think we're going to go down memory lane and in the 2016 period.
Yeah. Pre-pandemic rehearsing and music making. Well, let's have a listen to the Haydn then.
Okay.
Bravo, that sounded fantastic.
Thank you.
Where did you record this? And it was filmed beautifully too. I really liked it. Did you edit this too, Steffani? Or is this
No, I did not. We recorded this down in Birmingham, I think.
It was wonderful.
Laura's husband is a recording engineer, and so he did the recording for us, and we had a video crew come out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you said Nurit mentioned Memory Lane, and I don't live in Birmingham anymore, and so Steffani was remembering rehearsing in my old house, and but that's on the campus of University of Alabama at Birmingham, and we went there, and like she said, my husband Jason did the audio, and then Seed Creative did the video. That was our first video.
Yeah.
Oh wow. That's quite a trip down memory lane, I can imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
And I love how all of you have such useful spouses. You know.
Yeah, right.
True.
Everyone's part of this. Everyone's into this together.
There's it takes a village.
It takes a village to raise a string quartet. Now I know you're performing in Carnegie Hall. Let's not forget to mention July 1st, 2024, 7 p.m. You're performing in the Vial Recital Hall. What are you performing, and how did this all come about? Tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, we're really excited. It's our Carnegie Hall debut on July 1st,
Wonderful.
We're playing a piece called In Floribus. And it's by a Romanian composer, Livia Teodorescu. And it's a wonderful work. It's in two movements. The first movement is quite a bit longer. It has a little bit faster than the second movement. And the whole thing is maybe about 15 minutes long. And we're really excited. As part of the concert, we get to work with her multiple times in advance. We've already been communicating with her, which is just always exciting.
Amazing.
To get to talk to the composer. You know, if only we could do that with Haydn and these other composers. We have so many questions, and the composer's been so wonderful and welcoming. So we're really excited to play it. We're also going to be recording it as part of the project, so people can kind of stay tuned for a recording of it once, probably after the performance, not before. So that's been it's been a really fun project, and certainly great for the quartet to play on one of the world's greatest stages.
Fantastic. Yeah, speaking of sort of with the composer, I mean, now we have AI, which you can kind of, you know, you can put a prompt that says, oh, draw me New York City in the style of Monet, you know, and it's always that ability to access the past. And what would Haydn compose if he could be here for a week and just sit and absorb music and write something for us? And I wonder what he would write. That's very cool. And so you get to work with a living composer and take notes. How's that process been? Do you send her your recordings, like the rehearsal recordings? How has it been?
So it depends. And in this case, they're going to set it up so that we can be live, and it's going to be, so that's going to be great. And that's ideal. I think a lot of composers are really busy and they've got groups playing their pieces all over the world. And so they can't rehearse with every group playing their piece. With other composers, we've made a recording and sent it and said, like, here's our list of questions. Or sometimes we'll even record. I know I've sometimes just recorded myself just saying questions, and it's much easier to just record myself rather than like type it out. You know, in measure three, is this the sound? So I'll just play. Is this what you want? Is this what you want? And I think composers appreciate, you know, there's no composer in the room, but I think they appreciate that we care so much to ask these questions and want to make their work come alive in the best way we can. And generally composers they're very grateful for questions and want to make sure that we're all on the same page working towards the same goal.
Yeah, I feel like we're in an era of such high performing ability. And I wonder sometimes, you know, you hear stories of Mozart's or Beethoven's orchestras and how kind of they're kind of slapped together. They get the music the day off and it kind of goes. And they don't often get to hear really incredible performers play their music, whereas now we have such a great population of great players, and now that they get to work with composers, it's almost like so much is possible and they can fine-tune what they really mean by the notes they write.
Yeah, I thought this is like the great composers would be really love to hear their music today. And not that it wasn't great then, but you've got great people playing it in fabulous spaces and having thought about it. I mean, these pieces have lived, some of them for centuries. And I feel pretty optimistic about how people play classic work, that the composers would think it's pretty awesome.
And the projection, you know, we have steel strings and, you know, that versus gut strings. And they're like, oh, that's, I would write it this way then if I knew that in 100 years time they have this technology. That's fantastic. I always imagine like Beethoven, you know, putting his ear to the wooden board to hear and then to imagine like if he could compose on a steel frame piano and to really just get that big, much bigger sound. It must be so fascinating for composers now to have all that available to them.
Yeah. And I've always wondered, you know, whoa, if with, there's a lot of modern notation that's different from standard notation in terms of graphic notation or just different kinds of markings and different ways of putting. And I've always thought, like, what if Dvorak had that at his disposal? Or what if Haydn did? And what would they have done? I think they would have been like wildly creative with it. And it would have been just more cool tools for them to use.
Yeah. Yeah. And we have much better health care now. So they'll live much longer, too. <That's> Well, they're dying way too soon.
Right.
Well, let's have a listen to your Mendelssohn clip. I really, really enjoyed that. And then we'll sort of gradually wrap up the show with a few more questions. So if you're okay with that, let's have a listen to the Mendelssohn.
Okay, great.
It's beautiful.
Thank you.
There must be more. So I definitely want to hear the whole thing. So this is pre-logo. This is pre-logo Bayberry String Quartet.
I think you're right.
Or
I think you're right.
I forgot.
Maybe it's not on there.
maybe. Okay. Wonderful. So I have just a question to all of you, I guess. I, as someone who's, you know, in music as well, and I'm sure a lot of people listening are, how do you balance everything? You're teaching, you're doing so many different things in your life. Stephanie, apparently you dance as well, and professionally maybe, I'm not sure, but like this idea where you're teaching, you're performing, you have a professional string quartet, and you must have, you know, family and friends and social activities and things are developing, and yet you still have all these things going on. And I just see so much joy in the way you make music as well, all of you. That do you have any advice? How do you balance it all? How do you make sure you tend to things properly? Or is it just, it just happens because there are deadlines and then things have to happen and they do.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. It's definitely like a balancing act. I think we all have so many things that we're trying to do every day, really. And one of the things that's been so great about working with this group is that I think we all sort of have the quartet at a similar priority. So we're all like, you know, investing time, and part of the way we work is doing these recordings. So like, for example, Nurit loves to work at 1 a.m. in the morning. So she can, you know, she can do her work when she has free time or when she wants to, you know, and we all have sort of our different schedules that we're operating on. And so it's nice to be able to feel like we're doing work for the quartet sort of on our own time. And then we have, you know, we have set meeting times that we meet up. But, you know, even if we're not meeting with the quartet in a day, I'm spending an hour or two on, you know, on quartet work, which has really been great.
Yeah, and it's such a deep question you ask, you know, that I think is really on everybody's mind, is, and there are so many different answers. Like I believe there are musicians out there who feel you shouldn't balance, that you should, you know, put all of your efforts into the art and wake up and go to bed thinking about it. And I guess as I've aged, I don't agree with that. I think that it's important that you have a hierarchy of putting people in your life first. And so family, friends, neighbors, and then finding the right people to work with. people who are, you know, have maybe have high standards, but are also nurturing and are okay with hearing you at your worst. And that's where it starts to get more complex. If you want a really sustainable life in music, I think it's really important that you prioritize relationship first. And of course, you know, daily practice and all the things that you hear, we hear standard, you know, that I think if there's one thing I could have done differently when I was a young musician, it would have been to remember that your instrument doesn't love you back. And so you do well to make sure you prioritize people, you know, high up on that list, you know.
It's always a conundrum in a way too, whereby I feel as a pianist, you don't get paid to practice and you get paid to rehearse, or you get to, you get for the gig itself, or, but the practice is so integral to the craft, not only to, you know, being prepared, of course, but the idea you're not cramming, but you're working things out. So you're improving. So it's still sort of like you're in school, but you're continue to work on it. And yet there may be other things that you could do where you do get paid per hour or you do get a yearly salary or something like that. And it's always this conflict with fighting about with what's more important, you know, and what is healthy. And I found for me, it's you go through seasons. There's going to be times when you're going to practice a lot more, and there's going to be times when you're just dashing about doing the different things and you don't practice as much, or you don't work on your craft as much. You might still be practicing and rehearsing, but it's different. Do you feel that? Does it get better, or is it always this kind of working things out as you go?
I think it really becomes what you create for yourself. And I think that, you know, deciding that you're going to have that the practice is a part of your life, and that, you know, the same way a yoga practice would be part of your life, I think is really important. And realizing that as much as, at least in our house, Steffani and I, we try to prioritize a certain type of practice that doesn't involve striving too hard for too long. Of course, as concerts get closer, we have to work a certain way, but we also try to find a certain level of calm within the practice. And that's actually how we improve the most. So trying to stay with, you know, the rudiments and with building craft as much as possible is something that I highly recommend. It keeps you grounded. But you're right, it's very easy to get carried away when the performances start to pick up with just getting yourself prepared, and that's it. You know, that's all you.
It's like squeeze. It becomes a bit of a squeeze.
Yeah, I find. Squeeze. Yeah.
Are you teaching at Chautauqua? What's that going to be like at the Chautauqua School of Music? Are you coaching together as a group and performing, I assume? What's that going to be like this summer?
We do teach together. We're teaching at a couple of summer institutes. At Chautauqua, Nurit teaches there. She's taught there every summer for a while now. So she's there much longer than we are. We're coming in for just a concert as a group. We are teaching at the Chicago Suzuki Institute. Right after, actually, the next day, we're going to Chicago, and we're teaching at the Peaks to Plains Suzuki Institute and as for their chamber program. So we've done workshops together. You mentioned in the earlier part of the show, we've taught at the Step Birmingham Chamber Music Workshop. So it's something, teaching is a part of all of our lives, and something we think we really care about, you know, kind of passing along what we've learned. And so that's something that we do and that we all have in common. But not at Chautauqua.
Wonderful. Yeah. And what will you be performing at Chautauqua? Just so, you know, if people are around the area, they want to go. Are you doing this, the new piece as well?
We're doing a great program. it's going to be at the Saturday, I believe, June 29th. at 4:15 at Chautauqua. It's on their website. And we're going to open with a piece by another living female composer, Ellen Zwillich, a piece called Voyage. And we're going to play a Mozart quartet. And then we're going to finish with Dvorak American, which is such a treat for everyone.
Reliable.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, it's a classic for a reason.
Amazing.
So.
I mean, you want to get those CDs sold, right? You want to show the Mozart, get the living composer, and then a blockbuster to end and get those people buying CDs and signing them and everything, right?
Right. Yeah. It's hard not to get excited about Dvorak American. Yeah.
There's something just so uplifting about it too. Yeah. I can imagine. Wow.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Yes. So let's end with another performance, this little Philip Glass piece. I wish we could play much more of your music, but we have these clips and I think they're just a wonderful way to introduce our audience to it. So let's hear it now. It's a suite for Bent for string quartet. And this is the first movement. That's amazing. Yeah, we need more. That's for sure. But you have recorded the whole thing, right? The whole suite on just no.
We performed it. I don't think we ever recorded the whole thing. You talk about Dvorak being a fan favorite, and Philip Glass. We get asked to play Glass a fair amount, and people and others who are a fan favorite. And that's from a movie. He's written, of course, a lot of string quartets, just like string quartet number one, number two, number three. But that's a particular suite. So they have these short little movements that were part of the soundtrack to that movie.
Such a teaser. That's
Right, I was just thinking that too. We should have recorded more.
It's okay. There's always time. I'm so glad this is all happening, and maybe we'll get to hear a lot more of that performance in the Carnegie Hall and the rehearsals, and that whole process will be really, really interesting. We're going to wrap up the show. I'm just going to tell everybody about our upcoming season, and then we'll say bye to you and to everybody as well. So we have some really exciting deadlines coming up. Like I mentioned at the beginning of the show, we have Carnegie Hall as well as Corkershaw auditions on May 17th to 21st as well as June 14th to 17th. And these are all opportunities to audition for judges. And these judges are usually either part of the organizations, like for example, the conductor themselves, or they are wonderful musicians who love music and would love to share their feedback, and they're used to doing that. And I think it's really fruitful. So if you're considering applying or you have students, please send them over, because I think not only do they get amazing opportunities through us, but also through performing and the whole live stream process and be able to connect with the judge. I always find when you perform and you don't know what the judges are thinking or anybody thinks, and you just turn off the video and that's it, it leaves you kind of empty. To be able to have that feedback seems, for me at least, to give you a bit of closure. And I think that's been a resounding success, or part of the success of this amazing organization. So the deadline is coming up. Please check our websites at virtualconcerthalls.com. We have soundexpressivecompetition.com, progressivemusicians.com, and coreorchestra.com. And these are all different parts of our organization, but the deadlines are pretty similar. And please feel free to check us all out. We also have a Beethoven documentary show every Thursday and Sunday. And this is really part of a passion project of Virtual Concert Halls to bring and to dissect the symphonies to our audience. We have the amazing Lawrence Rapchak, who is a fantastic conductor as well as a narrator. His voice is fantastic and so phenomenal, and he's able to bring so much light to all the amazing symphonies. We go movement by movement, and we talk about the intricacies of each movement and everything that happens in between, from the historical context to the cultural context to some of his own little scribblings. It's fantastic. And so we have a show on every day. I want to make sure we thank our collaborators, people who have been part of not just this show, but all the whole season. We have these people who continue to contribute, whether you're an orchestra or the Adult Oaks Music Library, summer festivals, the Cicerone Music and Art is featured there too, and they are offering album recording and distribution for some of our musicians. We've been in collaboration with the Coleman School since the very beginning. So please, if you want to join us and be a part of our organization and to give opportunities to young and excellent talented musicians, please let us know. I want to make sure we thank our team as well, the amazing team who not only puts the script together, but hosts the show, directs the show, has the amazing graphics that you see on the screen, and make sure that everyone is tech checked properly. We do offer tech checks as part of our package, which means that you will sound the best and hopefully look your best for the show. And these include our tech team who make sure your microphone's placed right, it's connected properly, and we offer the best audio and sound system for our live stream viewers. And with that, we're going to bring our guests back on the show and thank everybody. This has been a wonderful show. Thank you for being part of our show. It's amazing.
Thank you so much, Chris. You're so great. You're just such a great interviewer and host, and it's great to be with you.
Yeah, thank you.
Likewise. I hope we get another chance to talk about it. Maybe after the album's release, we can have another conversation about it and listen to a few clips. You didn't record the video for that. It's just audio. Am I right?
That's right.
Well, for the Mozart, we're going to have audio and video eventually. Yeah.
Okay, well, this is great. Well, I'm looking forward to it. We'll do it again. Amazing. Well, thank you for watching, and we'll see you all next time. Bye for now.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.